Every year, my family would get together for July 4th in Bristol, Rhode Island. It was a big deal, because Bristol boasts the longest-running 4th of July parade in the country.
Oh, here comes the flag of freedom without a slave. We'll fight to defend it as our fathers did so brave. The gun come here.
We'd watch the parade from the lawn of Linden Place. This big white mansion used to belong to my relatives. It's right in the center of town. This is me, age two, with my mother and grandmother. Here's me, age three, bossing my brother around. My DeWolf ancestors were known as the Great Folk in Bristol. There were professors and writers, artists and architects, and many Episcopal ministers. I was proud to be related to them. I was also drawn to this fairy tale world of old New England, these images of my grandparents when they were young. It never occurred to me to ask how we got so established. One day, my grandmother traced back. I was in seminary when I got a booklet in the mail that she wrote for all her grandchildren. She shared our family history, all the happy days. She also explained that the first DeWolf, Mark Anthony, came to Bristol as a sailor in 1744. And then she wrote, "I haven't stomach enough to describe the ensuing slave trade." What hit me hard was the realization that I already knew this. Knew, but somehow buried it along the way. What no one in my family realized was that the DeWolfs were the largest slave trading family in U.S. history. They brought over 10,000 Africans to the Americas in chains. 500,000 of their descendants could be alive today. Many Rhode Island ships came to Havana. In my mind, Cuba was about Castro and old American cars. I never knew that Havana was one of the largest slave markets in the world. For decades, Northerners came here from Africa, flaunting their state laws. Some continued even after the federal ban in 1808, when the U.S. as a whole abolished the slave trade. The island was a real hub for illegal traders. The DeWolfs developed 5 sugar and coffee plantations on the island to reap more profits and create greater control of their own triangle of commerce. Oyla Lapique, a research librarian, showed us a map that had the names of DeWolf plantations on it. I was struck by the date on the map, 1875. Long after the Civil War and abolition, and the family might have still owned plantations down here. We set off to find one of the plantations. So much had happened there. I wondered what was left today. on our way, I thought we should try to get a feel for the lives of enslaved Africans.
The way they would mark the start of the work day.
That's a marsh.
It seemed like a good idea at first, but it only got more and more absurd. It culminated with a so-called slave meal. We were served 5 courses of food that slaves supposedly ate.
I feel real, I feel a lot of confusion, a lot of emotion. I'm having a real problem with, I don't know what to call it, the itinerary. It just feels way out of balance to me. How it's feeling right now is that it's going to show up as a really neat travelogue about slavery. But damn, I need to have us connect more between each other on a feeling level. A lot is going on between us, and we're just being our nice Protestant selves, and I'm sick of it.
I'm having a lot of the same feelings, that we're doing all kinds of interesting things, and I mean, I'm real interested in Ghana and I'm real interested in Cuba, but here's a group of 10 people who seem to be together ready to talk about race in the United States, and we're not talking about it. And I want to talk about, what do we do when we go home? What do we do when this is over? And
maybe I wasn't setting things up right. But now it was obvious. We needed to sit down and talk.
Two races must be able to cry together. For true redemption to take place, for true peace to take place, if the hurt of the abused is unable to forgive the perpetrator, there will never be the kind of peace or redemption that we need to have in the world.
Whites don't even talk about race. How can we ask for forgiveness from black people?
I'm not asking for forgiveness today. I'm saying down the road.
We can't have any expectations.
I don't hear anyone saying that they expect forgiveness.
Certainly not.
But we do have somebody saying that if we don't get it, it's not going to work, which is pretty much the same damn thing.
Dane's saying eventually.
You know, I agree from like a, you know, human, theological, emotional level. I totally agree with that, but I think it's not for us to say that until we've done everything in our power to apologize in word and deed. And then step 2 is that it's for black Americans to decide what they want to do with that.
We kept arguing. Should we be more focused on talking with white people or black people?
I'm afraid this very quickly becomes a lot of whites talking to each other doing this. I would hope most people would agree that there's always the danger of becoming self-indulgent.
What I'm hoping that you have been hearing is every single black person that's talked to us has said exactly that. You white people need to talk to white people. That's what they've said.
I want to know what you mean by self-indulgent.
Oh, great.
What do you mean by
Absolutely.
That?
Absolutely.
Because,
Can you
be a little
I'm worried about a bunch of white people thinking very hard about their ancestors and what the slave trade meant to them, and the danger that in isolation we can start trying to assuage our sense of guilt and shame because we've decided we've dealt with it and feel better about it, rather than dealing with the consequences, the living consequences today.
For me, talking like this with each other was a way to assuage guilt. It's true. But in a good way, it was a first step, like getting therapy. So then I'd be ready to tackle real issues in the world. All of a sudden, Ellie was upset. She wanted to talk to Juanita, who was in the room. Juanita didn't intend to be part of family discussions. so we wouldn't censor ourselves and she wouldn't be put on the spot. But we all got close, so she decided to sit in. Now Ellie was worried about what it was like for her to listen to us. So a bit awkwardly, we all turned to Juanita.
You know, like, given all that's happened, and am I not angry? And the entire truth is that, you know, in this moment, you're just a good person to me. And also the truth, and of course I'm angry at white people, you know? I think white people have been cowards and have chosen to give up their integrity and their humanity for so long, knowing what's happened to my people. Like, it's ridiculous. If you grew up where I grew up, you'd be pissed off, you know? Anybody who's alive, you know, or who's paying attention should be pissed off, you know? And the fact that white people are not pissed off means that they're not paying attention. So, I mean, that's, and it's helpful for me. Like, the reason why I'm doing this is because it's important for me that white people take responsibility and that ultimately, it's about human liberation, and also it's about liberation of my people. It's about liberation of you guys. That's the truth.
We were ready to go home, but I still wanted us to get to George DeWolf's plantation. General George DeWolf was from the third generation of slave traders. He named his plantation Arca de Noé, Noah's Ark. The diary of the plantation overseer. On April 14th, 1821, he wrote, "The first Negro I struck was this evening for laughing at prayers." In another diary, there was a painting of Peter. This is the only image of an African owned by the DeWolves that I've been able to find. On February 24th, 1833, the overseer wrote, "Dear reader, I have not yet made you acquainted with Peter. Peter is our cook. You must see Peter. I will attempt a likeness. Peter, on rainbow legs, stalks round, something between a whale and a weasel."
Now, do we know that this was part of the plantation?
Yeah.
Yes.
We just don't know what building it was. You know, if this was the house or the slave quarters or
storage areas.
Or the mill or.
I remember the description in the book talking about the proximity to the Gulf is such that he would be able to look out and see the ships come in. And this is during the illegal period. Linden Place is the result of all that. Linden Place was built by George DeWolf from his fortune made during 1 year of the illegal trade.
You know, we don't spend a lot of time talking about these sorts of things in history class. This is kind of glossed over, and it's glossed over, it's kind of ignored. Slavery is brought up as a principal reason that the Civil War was fought, and the mighty North took care of that problem, and then on we go to the Industrial Revolution and flying at Kitty Hawk and then men on the moon. That's sort of how it goes. And
so let's just have some time where people can just be here and do whatever you need or want to do.
Let's piss on the building. Kind of your ritual.
Mm-hmm. All that I'm aware of wanting to do is get out of here.
Yeah, I'm ready to go.
The mosquitoes and heat were getting to me too, but I stayed. These abandoned ruins made history so close somehow. I couldn't help thinking about parallel universes. Comfortable New England versus what was going on down here. It was all starting to add up. In the 19th century, after the slave trade was outlawed, northern ships were bringing sugar and coffee from the islands and cotton from the southern states, all harvested by slaves. European immigrants processed these raw materials in textile mills and other factories all over the north. In exchange, equipment and supplies were sent southward. So that sugar press we'd seen was from Buffalo. Buffalo, New York. Fueling this commerce were ordinary consumers, rich, poor, and in between. People sitting in their homes in the abolitionist North, enjoying coffee and sugar. The suffering was out of sight and out of mind.
It's hard to say because I didn't live then, but you know, there's stuff that goes on today that we all accept as normal that isn't, and in 100 years, people might be looking at it the same exact way, you know? I buy stuff that's made by people that aren't getting paid what they're worth at all the time, you know?